Hey, and welcome back. I recently bought this machine on a classified ad, and it was kind of an impulse buy, not for the machine as such, but we'll get to that in a few minutes. But don't really know what I've got here, so let's get the screwdriver out and take a look. Right, so we've got quite a cool looking little tower here. It's clearly from eMachines, a company I don't really know much about, but I remember seeing them around in magazines and such, and the model is 530. It's quite a funky little thing, apart from that horrible silver CD writer that somebody's put in there, though that looks like it might be an eMachines model as well, because it kind of matches that kind of curved bezel that we have here. And then there's a sort of big dirty glue mark down there as well, which I think on these machines there used to be a sticker there with the sort of breakdown of all the internal spec of the machine. So at the top we've got a nice matching beige DVD-ROM, then the silver one that totally breaks the look and feel of this machine, so that's going to have to come out. Usual 3¼ floppy drive, a power light, and then a funky green power switch that matches the logo quite nicely. Then at the bottom we've got one of these funky trapdoors, so I guess there's going to be USB ports underneath there, and ooh, game port as well, so that's a cool idea. So you can plug your joystick in at the front and you're not constantly fumbling around at the back like usual on your sound card. Okay, round to the back, we've got a power supply, looks like a small format one, maybe an SFX or something like that. Some stickers with some serial numbers and stuff on it. And there's a gaping hole for a fan, but it doesn't look like there's a fan in there. And then details for serial number for Power DVD. Yeah, this was the age of the Media Center PC. Windows XP Home Edition was installed originally by the looks of it. Serial number there too. We seem to have the obligatory fax modem, so that'll probably be coming out as well. And we've got a graphics card, so that could be interesting. Pretty basic I/O panel. We've got PS2 for mouse and keyboard. This was the age where USB was pretty well established. We have one serial port and one parallel port for the printer. Dust. We have two more USB ports here. And we have the usual three sockets for the onboard sound. Pop the lid off. Unfortunately, this isn't one with the nice side panels. It's one with the complete kind of floppy all around cover, which are a bit more of a pain to work with. First thing out, since it's done a nice little caddy at the front, is our hard drive. So we've got a Hitachi DeskStar, and it's a 164 gigabyte drive, and it's a 7200 RPM drive, so that's quite cool. Okay, let's see what we've got with this graphics card. So it's a Radeon 9550, 256 megabytes, 128 bit bus. I don't think this is a particularly fast card. It'd probably do the job for some sort of light XP gaming, but to be honest, I was planning on building a much more powerful XP gaming rig than this, so this isn't really about creating a machine to play most of my XP games on. This is more just like restoring the machine to its former glory, because it's the right thing to do in a retro gaming world. Okay, I see why there was no fan in that hole at the back. So there's this great big vent that sits over the top of the CPU cooler and vents the air directly from the CPU cooler out through that grid at the back. It's just held on by a couple of clips at the back, and yeah, I thought there'd be lots of shit inside, so that's going to need a clean. Okay, we'll get the memory out. So it looks like this thing came with a gig, and somebody's put another 512 megabyte stick in there, so a gig and a half of RAM isn't bad. Everything's pretty clean looking inside. It's a lot of dust. The CPU cooler is pretty caked with cack, but I think everything just is going to need a bit of a brush and a wipe. So we need to get the drives out because they hang over the back and stop the motherboard coming out, which I've just discovered. So we'll pop them all out, and the first one out is that silver CD rewriter. It's made by Hitachi LG Data Storage Incorporated. So we won't be using that, put it to one side. Next out is the DVD-ROM, the beige one, which we are going to keep, and that's from Samsung. I mean, I don't know if I'm a fan of these funky beige bezels. Curved bezels, rather. I mean, they look good, but might be a bit of a pain to replace if the drive fails. And then finally we've got our 3¼ floppy drive, and that's from Trigem. And with all the drives out of the way, we can ease that motherboard out of the case and take a closer look. Wow, look at that. It's almost like this thing has a fur coat. There's so many balls of fluff and hair and shit on it. And yeah, the inside of the case isn't that much cleaner, so I'm going to pop the PSU out so we can get at the fan and give that a clean. And it's not really that dirty, it's still very new. It just needs a wipe, basically, so I'll take the case off and get rid of all of that fluff. Just look at the CPU cooler. Have you ever seen a fuzzier thing than that in your entire life? It does say Cooler Master under there somewhere, I think. The motherboard on this thing is DL845, and that's about the only information I could find about it. I do have the manual, which we'll get to in a minute. No real references online apart from in eMachine user forums where people are asking about upgrading memory and stuff. I don't know whether I might be able to find this on Station.org or something like that, but I don't think there's any real need with having the manual. But I do know that it is fairly limited in what you can do with it. So the manual does actually state that this thing is limited to processors of a 400 MHz frontside bus and 256 kilobytes of level 1 cache. The 845 chipset that it uses actually came out in a few different versions, so two of them didn't support AGP, so I know it's not either of those, which means that this is 845GE or 845G, and both of those support a 533 MHz side bus as well as the 400, but there's no access to change it in the BIOS here, so I don't know whether there was an update for it or not, but I'm probably not going to bother. So the AGP on this thing is 4x AGP, though I think one of the versions accepts the universal 8x cards, but I don't think this is that board, which probably narrows it down actually. It probably means that this is the 845G chipset. Memory-wise, this thing takes either DDR266 or PC133, so at the minute I've got PC133 in the machine, so there's a potential for a memory upgrade there at some point, because the DDR266 should be a bit faster, I think. All of the rest of the I/O and stuff is pretty standard as you expect. The processor in this thing is a Pentium 4 1.5 GHz, 400 MHz frontside bus, so that means it's a Willamette stepping of the processor, one of the early ones, which were very poor performers and even couldn't quite beat some of the faster Pentium 3s, got soundly trashed by AMD Athlons, and even sometimes trashed by AMD Duron. So in the beginning, they weren't the greatest chips in the world, so this isn't really a high performer. Having said all that, I like this machine. I really do like the look and feel of it, and I have no aversion to having a fairly lowly Pentium 4 in my collection. We'll just get it put back together and then we can see what it can do. So I'm not going to do any benchmarking on this machine right now, though I do think it would be an interesting little project, having just read about those early Pentium 4s not being great performers. It would be interesting to match it up against something like a 1.3 Tualatin Pentium 3 and a 1.5 Duron and 1.5 Athlon, and see how they all compare with each other. That wouldn't be strictly fair because it'd be different motherboards and stuff, but you could use the same memory and graphics card, so that might be a project for the future. I did power it up when I first got the machine, and I did have some problems with it. It wasn't happy with the graphics card or the graphics driver, I'm not sure which, so I had to go into safe mode and unload the Radeon drivers that were on this originally, so I'm not sure if there's a problem with the card or not, but we'll find out in a minute. And we've got a gaping hole where that horrible silver drive used to be, so go through my drive bay blank collection, see if I can find something that fits, and in the long run I'll keep an eye out on eBay and hopefully I'll get one of the correct kind that goes with this particular kind of curved front bezel. Yeah, so even though that bezels I have aren't curved. Even the flat bezel looks pretty sweet on this machine. This one's a bit yellow, but I'll try and find a better color match. I've got some other ones kicking around. So I've just dropped in a new coin cell and we'll go into the BIOS. It's a very, very basic BIOS. There isn't really much to see in here and certainly nothing in the world of overclocking to mess about with. And set the date and time and then see if she boots into Windows. So cool, we're booting into Windows XP Home Edition without any issues. This is a pretty good machine in that Windows XP can be a pain in the arse because you can't register it anymore, at least in the UK. The phone lines were closed. I know they were open till fairly recently that you could use the phone registration, but I tried it a while back on a different machine and they're not working here. But there is a registry hack and there are ways of getting around it. It's just a bit of a pain. So, and I think there's also some other YouTubers have created images that have this hack already included in them, so you don't have to worry about it. But what we have here, or seems to have here, is a clean install from the eMachine's discs, because Power DVD and everything is there and nothing else has been installed. There's one Lord of the Rings game that's been installed that needs a CD, so I can't play it, but coincidental, Lord of the Rings, as we'll find out in a minute. But yeah, so I'm going to keep this install as it is. I'm not going to overwrite it with a fresh install, and it's pretty much good to go out of the box. So it's always nice to have the bits and pieces. So we've got our discs here, we've got our basic user guide, we've got a motherboard manual, and we've even got the original packaging for the extra memory module that was added to the machine. So eMachines is quite an interesting company. They were a typical sort of dot-com bubble company. They started in 1998 in South Korea, and they floated on the stock market in 2000, right at the peak of the dot-com bubble. And literally within a year, their stock was trading through the floor, and they sort of soldiered on for a bit. And they were bought up by Gateway in 2004, and then gradually faded away into oblivion. But they were a sort of budget-oriented company. I think they sold all of their PCs at either $399 or $499. And these machines, surprisingly, really hold their value on eBay as well. I was quite shocked when I was looking for mice and things to go with it, just how well these things seem to hold their value. You can see there that the original keyboard came with this machine. No mouse, unfortunately, but I have managed to find a white eMachines mouse on eBay, which is cool. I thought about putting another graphics card in. I've got this nice 9800 Pro, but I don't think that this particular processor is going to do it any justice. So I'm going to persevere with the 9550, load up the drivers and see if it indeed works or whether there are any problems. I've got the drivers from AMD's website, so they should be good. And so let's see what happens. Yeah, so as you can see, we've got some fairly major screen corruption here. So I tried uninstalling, reinstalling, different resolutions, nothing made any difference. It's pretty unusable. So there's definitely an issue with this card. So I think we're going to have to try and find something else to use. Now, bit of sad farewell to the Radeon 9550. Now I was digging through my box of cards and I found this. I had this in my IBM Pentium 3 originally, I think. So this is a Sapphire Radeon 9600 Atlantis. It's only 128 megabytes, but it's kind of in the same ballpark as the 9550. And for this processor, I think this will be a reasonable card. So we're going to shove this in and see how this works. So I'm pretty sure that the Catalyst drivers I've just loaded for the 9550 should work with this. So it should just be a case of plonking it in and seeing what happens. And yeah, that seems to be working absolutely fine. So it definitely looks like there's an issue with that 9550, which is a bit of a shame. So since this thing has Power DVD on it, I was quite into messing about with media centers back in the day. Had one of those funky cases underneath my TV, ran my TV through the tuner card in the PC, ran all my DVDs through this particular bit of software, which was an utter nightmare from what I remember. It was constantly flaky and dropping out. But I need to remember what it was like, so I'm going to pop in my favourite movie, Blade Runner, just for a couple of seconds, and just capture that vibe for the last time, maybe. So what to do with this machine? So what I thought was, I've been hankering for a while to replay some of my favourite games from the XP era, Lord of the Rings Battle for Middle Earth, and the first game, I just loved this game dearly, so I'm going to play that again, and that probably falls within the spec of this machine. I also played Lord of the Rings Battle for Middle Earth 2, which wasn't so good, but was still fun, but a thing I didn't have back in the day was the expansion pack, which is The Rise of the Witch King. Now this thing isn't cheap. I was quite shocked. This must be a little bit of a collector's item or something, because it is probably cost more than it cost when it first came out on eBay, whereas the others go for a few quid. This thing still costs like £40 or £50. But I got a copy anyway, and this one might be a little bit too much for the spec of this machine, so I'm going to start playing them in order. I might have to move to another machine for this when I come around to playing it though. Okay, now that we know the graphics card's working properly, we can put the lid back on. There's a little bit of cleaning to do on there with all of that gluey, gunky shit. So, get this screw back together, and then I'm going to try and wipe this off with a bit of IPA. IPA's kind of taken off, but not really. So I've got some proper gunky glue remover stuff, which always does the job. So, yeah, that's coming up nicely. So, I picked up the computer, but it wasn't really what I went for. This was what I actually wanted. So, the guy wanted 20 quid for the whole lot. I can't remember, it wasn't very much money at all. But it was really the 17-inch CRT I wanted, and just happened to get the computer free. Then I was kind of a bit disappointed that, you know, it wasn't an E Machines monitor and it didn't match the machine. But I've since found out that eMachines didn't sell monitors. They only sold the base units, the keyboard and the mouse, and you had to provide your own monitor. So this is exactly as that eMachine would have been in the wild, with a monitor provided by the owner. But yeah, we're going to replace that LCD with this and see how it looks. Yeah, it looks nice. Even though the monitor doesn't match, it looks like a proper turn of the millennium PC setup to me, ready to rock with those Lord of the Rings games. So yep, as it boots up, it just is a different world. Super, super sharp CRTs, so much better than LCDs. Bring back CRTs. We'll get Lord of the Rings Battle for Middle Earth loaded up. It's just so much more satisfying. Putting in your DVD and loading up a game and having a leaf through the manual. So much more satisfying than just sitting waiting 4 hours for something to download off Steam or whatever. Here we go. Runs great on Pentium 4. Ooh, some nasty crackling going on there. I think my speakers may be dying. Yeah, the eMachines machine killed the JBL speakers I've been using for about a year. So, dug out another pair of Logitechs and see if this sounds any better.
Yeah, yes.
Thank you.
command of Mordor in the fires of Mount Doom. The Dark Lord Sauron forged in secret a master ring. And into this ring he poured his cruelty, his malice, and his will to dominate all life. One by one.
So cool, those speakers are working pretty nice. I just love that. I mean, if you're a Tolkien fan and you like the movies, this is the game to get. All the original cast doing the voice acting, all of the animation captured scenes from the films, it's just fabulous if you like the movies. So there it is, and what a funky little setup it is. It seems to run Lord of the Rings Battle for Middle-earth just great, so I'm going to play that through on this machine, and I might have to move to another machine for the expansion pack, because it jumps. I think the minimum processor requirement for this is a 1.3 gigahertz, and it asks for a 1.6 on the expansion, and given that this 1.5 wasn't a particularly great performing one, I might be better off moving to another machine when I come to play that. But that pretty much wraps it up for this. I'm really happy with the way this machine is restored. I did order a mouse to go with it, which I had hoped would be here in time to make this video, but it still hasn't arrived yet. But that's really going to set the machine off, I think. And I'm glad I picked it up. I'm glad I didn't just get the monitor. So there you go. I'm going to go off and play some Lord of the Rings now. So thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. It'd be great if you consider giving me a thumbs up, subscribing, or leaving a comment below if you did. And I hope to see you on the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Let's go now.
Arm is ready.
Come together, my friends.
My friends!